Good morning, Loft family. I am so glad that you are here with us on this beautiful day as we continue our Lenten series, Missed Opportunities. Well, there are many mysteries of human tragedy that have remained unsolved, and they often haunt us with their unanswered questions. Think about the assassination of JFK, or the mystery surrounding the death of Marilyn Monroe, or the questions around the assassination of Martin Luther King, or even ordinary people, like the death of JonBenet Ramsey, or the disappearance of Madeleine McCain. And often, those cases that go unsolved, they bring about a lot of speculation and a lot of theories about what might have happened. Now, growing up, I was a huge fan of unsolved mysteries. I did not want to miss an episode, and I can still remember that creepy intro music that they would play, and then the host would say, "Join me, because maybe you can help solve a mystery." Boy, and I was all in. And when Netflix issued a reboot in 2020, I binge-watched it in like a day. And there is no shortage of content, podcasts, documentaries, nonfiction books about real life cases. The true crime genre is bigger than ever. And Dr. Shavana Childs, a psychologist from the Cleveland Clinic, she explored why people are obsessed with true crime and the psychological effects that it can have on people. And she says, watching true crime doesn't make you strange or weird. Don't we all feel better about ourselves? It's human nature to be inquisitive. True crime appeals to us because we get a glimpse into the mind of a real person who has committed a heinous act. And so for shows like My Favorite Murderer or The Making of a Murderer, the motivation is often to try to understand what makes that person tick. How does a seemingly ordinary person turn evil and commit these terrible acts? What goes wrong? Well, if there was a such thing as true crime podcasts or documentaries in the first century, there is no doubt that this notorious biblical character would have made the list. Because there are mysteries and theories that abound about this notorious man. And the star of our true crime tale today is none other than Judas Iscariot. Judas is remembered in history as the man who was chosen by Jesus, who betrayed him for 30 pieces of silver. And John Piper says that the most spectacular sin that has ever been committed in the history of the world is the brutal murder of Jesus Christ, the morally perfect, infinitely worthy, divine Son of God. And probably the most despicable act in the process of this murder was the betrayal of Jesus by one of his closest friends, Judas Iscariot. Now that is the kind of sensational crime that podcasts and documentary dreams are made from. And as famous as Judas is, we really know very little about the man. We don't know where he came from. We don't know anything about his family. We don't know what he did before he met Jesus. We don't know how he met Jesus. We don't know how he was chosen or how he was called. And because of we don't know as much about Judas as we like to, there tends to be a lot of speculation and theories from scholars and extra-biblical resources about Judas. So some scholars would say that the name Iscariot places Judas not from Galilee, where all the other disciples were from, but from somewhere south of Jerusalem, which would have made Judas an outsider to the disciples. But the most popular theory about Judas is that the name Iscariot attaches him to a group of Jewish rebels, zealots, known as the Dagger Men, who opposed Roman occupation and committed acts of terrorism. But one of the biblical scholars that I read pointed out that we aren't sure if Judas was from the South, if he was a zealot, or if he was a rebel, and much of the speculation is an attempt to set Judas apart from the disciples and to try to explain why he would betray Jesus. But none of those theories or those ideas are actually documented by the gospel writers in the Bible. What we do know from the Bible is that Judas was for sure one of the 12 disciples. All four gospel writers, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, they all include Judas in the list of the disciples. And there is no indication from the gospels that Judas had anything but a sincere commitment to follow Jesus, that at one point he had a sincere faith. He did ministry with the disciples. Luke tells us that Jesus called the 12 together, and that would have included Judas, and he gave them power and authority over all demons to cure diseases, and he sent them out to proclaim the kingdom of God and to heal. So we know he did ministry. He had gifts. He had authority. He was there in the feeding of the 5,000. He saw the lame walk and the blind see. He saw the lepers restored. And he was a friend of Jesus. He lived with him. He talked with him. He followed him. He ate with him. So how does someone who has seemingly a sincere commitment to follow Jesus, a faith, a gift, a ministry, how does that person fall away from their faith and end up betraying Jesus? How did Judas miss his opportunity to remain faithful as a disciple of Jesus? So the book of John gives us the most insight into Judas. Now, listen, there is no love lost between John and Judas. So John gives us the most verses about Judas, but he is also the most brutal in his descriptions of Judas. And we have to remember that the Gospels were actually written in the years following the death and resurrection of Jesus. So they're accounting of his life and of his ministry. So when they're written, Judas would have already betrayed Jesus. And that's why whenever you find Judas's name in the Bible, generally there is a little tagline behind his name that identifies him as the one who betrayed Jesus. And there might be just a little bit of name calling, which honestly feels fair. So John tells us about a story at a dinner that happened in the days leading up to Jesus' death. It's found in John 12, verses 1 through 6. It says, 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, the home of Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. And there he gave a dinner for him. Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those at the table with him. Mary took a pound of costly perfume made of pure nard, anointed Jesus' feet, and wiped them with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume, but Judas Iscariot, one of the disciples, the one who was about to betray him, said, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and the money given to the poor?" Now, at face value, that seems like a fair question. The perfume could have brought a lot of money, and that money could have done a lot of good for the poor. But John is going to give us some insight into the heart and the mind of Judas Iscariot at this point. So when Judas asked, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and the money given to the poor?" John lets us know he said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. And he kept the common purse and used to steal what was put into it. So this is our first indication that somewhere along the way, something happened to Judas. Somewhere between committing to follow Jesus and active ministry, Judas gave himself over to active sin. Now, one of the things that I think about my faith sometimes, I think that it would be easier to follow Jesus if he was here with us. Like if I got to meet him and I could eat with him and I could be like one of the 12 and I could have his physical presence to follow, not just his spiritual one, that would make it easier to follow Jesus. But Judas's story shows that even those closest to Jesus can be susceptible to sin. So somewhere along the way, Judas was tempted and Judas gave in to sin. So what was he tempted by? Was he tempted by greed, pure greed? Possibly. He probably came from a life of poverty, and for sure the life that the disciples lived, moving from village to village, it wasn't a life of prestige or wealth. Was he tempted by the potential for power? Also likely. Was he tempted by ambition? Did he have bigger goals for himself or for Jesus? Also likely. Was he tempted by jealousy? Was he jealous of Jesus, his popularity, or potentially the relationship that Jesus had with other disciples? Likely. We don't know exactly what Judas was tempted by at the time, but I would imagine that all of those played a part in his temptation. But John gets straight to the point. And shortly after the story in Bethany, he tells us that the devil had already put into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. So how long had Judas harbored this sin in his heart? How long had he thought and schemed and planned deceit? How long had this been in his heart before he cracked open the door for the enemy to enter in? Because you see, when it comes to Satan, Satan can't just take over people unwillingly. He can't just come into people. Satan doesn't have that kind of power. Satan can't get a foothold into people who are walking in the light with Jesus. Satan traffics in the dark. He traffics in the secrets. And baseball player and evangelist Billy Sunday, he says that temptation is the devil looking through the keyhole, and yielding is opening the door and inviting him in. Now, ironically, Mercedes-Benz captured this idea in a 2013 Super Bowl commercial. Let's take a look.
Nice car.
Sure is.
Make a deal with me, kid. You can have the car and everything that goes along with it.
Please allow me to introduce myself. I'm a man with wealth and taste.
Give me smile, kid. Give me smile.
I've been around for a long year. Stole many a man's soul and faith.
Pleased to meet you.
Thanks, but I think I got this.
Now listen, I would really like to be tempted by a $29,000 Mercedes right about now. But I can tell you that in the times that I've been tempted to give in to sin, it has never looked like a devil that looks like Willem Dafoe with long fingernails handing me a pen and offering me things if I sign on the dotted line. Temptation, it's much less obvious than that. So in my life before I met Jesus was marked with relational conflict and strife. Junior high was miserable. High school was even worse. I went to college and joined a sorority, and it was brutal. And I think that it's hard enough for people who come from a childhood or upbringing of healthy relationships and communication. It can be hard enough to navigate all of those kind of relationships in that age. But for people who come from homes of relational brokenness and unhealthy relationships, it can be almost impossible to navigate in a healthy way. And honestly, I was really mean, like really mean girl stuff. And I could make a lot of excuses about why I was that way, the way I was treated, the difficult relationships or circumstances of my life. But really what it came down to is that I didn't know how to navigate conflict in relationships or emotions of my life in relationship with people. And so what I did, what I learned, and my number one mode of both offense and defense was to use my words to hurt people. I would take what they told me and use it against them. I would find the thing that I knew would hurt them the most, and I would use it to cut deeply. And my life after I gave my life to Jesus has been marked by radical transformation. I walked away from a life of alcohol and drugs. God has healed incredible wounds that have affected all areas of my life. God has completely changed my heart towards people and made me more loving and empathetic and compassionate and caring. But there are times where I am still tempted and I still struggle with what one might call the sin of an untamed tongue. There are times when my words get away from me, and I am tempted to revert back to using them. And I know how it happens. I can recognize it. It starts in my heart first. When I'm angry about something, when a person has hurt me or I think they're going to hurt me, when I become frustrated, when I'm impatient or short-tempered, or I run out of compassion for someone, or I've assigned motives to people in my mind, my words can just come pouring out of me. And while the Holy Spirit has done an extraordinary amount of work in providing the right heart and thoughts and minds to fight against that temptation, there are still times that my words are unkind and they're not helpful and they're hurtful to people. And if I'm honest, at times when I just give myself over to it and I just say whatever I want to say without a filter, it can initially feel really good. And I think, God, it'd be so much easier to live this way, where I could just say what I wanted to say if I just gave myself over to this sin. But in the aftermath, when I survey how much I've hurt someone and the damage that I've done to a relationship, I know that if I were to give myself over to this sin, then it would be complete relational wreckage with people that I love. And so you see, sin, it can start small in your heart, but if you harbor it, if you let it grow, what it does is it opens up the door wider and wider and wider, and ultimately will lead to destructive consequences. There is a spiritual progression that happens inside the human heart that goes from desire to temptation to sin and ultimately to death. And the book of James talks about this in James 1. He said, "Blessed is anyone who endures temptation. Such a one has stood the test and will receive the crown of life that the Lord has promised to those who love him. No one, when tempted, should say, 'I am being tempted by God,' for God cannot be tempted by evil, and he himself tempts no one. But one is tempted by one's own desire, being lured and enticed by it. Then when that desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and that sin, when fully grown, gives birth to death." And that progression happened with Judas. Immediately after the interaction with Jesus and the dinner in Bethany, Judas's sin of greed and theft and dishonesty, it progresses. It says, then one of the 12 who was called Judas Iscariot went to the chief priest. He said, what will you give me if I betray him to you? And they paid him 30 pieces of silver. And from that moment, he began to look for an opportunity to betray him. Judas made a choice. He decided that 30 pieces of silver was the value of his relationship with Jesus. He traded the goodness, the mercy, the grace, the promises, the ministry, his faith, everything that Jesus had given him for money. We live in a world that is full of temptation. We are tempted to give up and give in. We're tempted to be dishonest. We're tempted to be stingy. We're tempted to abuse power and substances. And Judas, he was tempted by money and power. But for us, it could be any number of things. If you were given a bag of coins, what are you tempted by? What are you tempted to trade your faith for? Is it image? The way that you misrepresent yourself to other people? Is it success? And the compromises that you're willing to make to your integrity to achieve it? Or perhaps it's lust, the affair you're having, the affair you're entertaining, or that screen that you just don't resist. Or perhaps it's relationships. Maybe it's gossip and a lack of integrity in your relationships. Maybe you're tempted by slander and the words that you speak about other people. Or perhaps, like Judas, you may be tempted by jealousy, comparing yourself to other people, being envious of other people, being discontent in your life. Or perhaps you're tempted by pride, which shows up in our lives in so many ways. And I think if you ask any person who has followed Jesus for any amount of time, they will tell you that it is difficult to persevere and to stand against sin. Because the reality is we are all tempted. So what do we do? How do we remain faithful? How do we persevere and overcome temptation? And what do we do when we fail? And the book of Hebrews gives us insight into temptation. It's a letter that was written to answer those questions. It was written for second generation Jewish believers who were tempted. They were tempted to give into sin and to give up on Christianity and to go back to their old way of living. And the answers are surprising because you think that it would be about having more willpower, exercising more discipline, saying no in the face of temptation. But instead, it tells us to do two critical things when faced with temptation. Hebrews 4, 14 through 16 says, since then we have a great high priest who has passed through heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. And the first thing it tells us to this is to hold fast to our confession. Some translations say it this way, hold fast to your profession. And what that means is to hold fast to your beliefs. The belief that Jesus is the Son of God and that his death and resurrection secured for us eternal life. It's the belief that our salvation is a gift of mercy and grace from a God who invites all in. It tells us to hold on to our beliefs, to cling to our faith, because in this life there will be times of pain and hardships, deep seasons of suffering, doubts and questions in our life with Jesus. And if we are not fully committed to our beliefs, if we are not fully surrendered to Christ as Lord of our life, that he is the most important thing to us, the things that we desire above all things, then we will be tempted and it will be easy to give up or give in. But we stand against temptation because we know that our identity is secure in our belief that we are a child of God, and nothing that comes against us can be not be overcome by him. And if you have not made that confession, if you have not professed your need for a Savior to become a child of God, you can do it today, and you will leave a different person. You will have a life full of strength and endurance and perseverance and hope. So the first thing we do is we hold fast to our confession. And the second thing we do is we draw near to God. And I think that it would make sense, it would be right, that if we fail, if we struggle, if we sin, if we're tempted, then the first place that we would go is that we would turn to God. But often, our shame, our embarrassment, our disappointment, our guilt, it keeps us from God. As we believe that he may be angry, that he may be disappointed in us, that he may judge us. And this passage in Hebrews, it's important for us because it's easy to believe that Jesus stopped understanding humanity after the resurrection. But the incarnation, which is God becoming flesh and dwelling among us, it means that Jesus knows what it's like to be human. Jesus knows what it's like to be tempted. So when he represents us before the throne of God, he is not representing us with judgment or condemnation or patronizing. He is representing us with sympathy. He sympathizes with our weakness and he offers grace and mercy for us. So we never have to fear drawing near to God in our failures and our struggles. We can be honest with him. And on the night that Jesus died, he gathers the disciples into the upper room for the Last Supper. And Judas was there. And Jesus knew at that supper that Judas was going to betray him. And even with that knowledge, Jesus offered him the body. He offered him his body broken for him. And he offered Judas the cup. He offered Judas his blood shed for him. He didn't condemn him. He didn't turn away from him. And then Jesus appears after his resurrection to the disciples. He appears to the ones who denied him, the ones who fled in fear, the ones who doubted him. And he offered them compassion and forgiveness and restoration. And that's the same thing that he offers us when we draw near to him, when we confess our sins, when we repent of the ways that we failed. Jesus is faithful to restore us. And it tells us that when Judas realized that Jesus was condemned to die, that he was seized with remorse. And he returned the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders and said, "I have sinned," he said, "for I have betrayed innocent blood." "What is that to us?" they replied. "That's your responsibility." So Judas threw the money into the temple and left, and then he went away and hanged himself. Instead of turning to Jesus in his failure with remorse, Judas instead chose death. And I don't know what you are struggling with, what you came here today wrestling with inside. Maybe it's a choice you've made. Maybe it's somewhere that you failed. Maybe it's your integrity that's been compromised. But I do know the way to freedom. And I do know the way to hope. And I do know the way to redemption. Because the story of Jesus, the gospel of good news, it's a story of overcoming. It's a story of redeeming. That there is no sin too great, no failure too big, no life too lost for the life-changing grace and mercy of the cross. So the way that we remain faithful and we don't miss our opportunity to stay faithful to Jesus is that we draw near to him, we hold fast to our beliefs, we confess our sins, and we allow him to forgive and redeem and restore us. Let's pray. Father God, we come into your presence this morning with a heart full of gratitude that you would send your son to die for us, that he would shed his blood and break his body so that we can draw near to you, that we have a compassionate, loving father who looks upon his children with grace and mercy and love and compassion. So God, right now, I just want to take a moment and ask you, God, in our hearts right now, would you reveal to us if there is sin or temptation, God, that is keeping us from being faithful to you? God, sometimes we know what it is, and it can easily come to our mind, the thing that we are tempted by or the sin in our lives, but sometimes we're blind to it. So won't you reveal that to us right now? Let us know if there is something that's keeping us from a faithful relationship with you. And now, Father, I take those things, God, and we place those at the foot of the cross. And we ask you to cover them with Jesus's blood, God, that we would be forgiven, that we would be restored, that we would leave here today free people. God, empower us to hold strong to our beliefs in a world full of temptation. God, we want to remain faithful to you. Thank you for providing the way. God, we commit these things and we pray these things in your precious Son named Jesus. Amen.